It's Primus Tracks with Josh and Frankie.
What a couple of dumps.
Hello, primates! Primus fans of all ages, heights, weights, hair colors, arm lengths, whatever you got going on, you found Primus Tracks. Congratulations. I am Josh, coming to you from Primus Tracks World Headquarters, and right across the glass from me is Frankie.
Hi, Josh.
We've got a track today that's really going to test that encyclopedic knowledge of yours as we approach. The air is getting slippery.
Oh, I'm quite eager to tackle that one.
I am approaching with trepidation because I know next to nothing about this track, especially the live history. When we get there, I will be listening and feverishly taking notes, like the rest of us. Looking forward to that. That's our track today. A few things before we jump into that. We are, of course, at Primus Tracks on Instagram and Twitter. You can find us there. Frankie's at Frankie Beristein. He is always posting cool stuff, actually. You had a couple of posts on Facebook and Instagram this week that were very interesting to me. One of them was about collecting.
Oh, right.
And I made fun of you. But what is... do you want to talk a little bit about collecting and that psychology? Like, give us the Cliff Notes version?
I think it's something that you are born with. I recall ever since I was a child, like when I developed interest in anything, I would always want to have everything related to that. I would always seek out to complete the collection. For example, if I had an interest in a particular show or, you know, a particular game, I would try to get the complete collection. And then once I had it, I wouldn't use it or play with those things. Like I would just keep them there in good condition. That was the fun for me, getting the collection complete, not actually using the toys or the figures or whatever. And that, of course, continued as I developed my interest in music. So whenever I get interested in a musical act, I'm also a very visual person. So the first thing I do is look at an overview of the discography of this artist or this band. And if the sleeve covers look attractive to me, that's the first step into getting more involved with the band. If I don't find their artwork interesting, or I think the covers are not done particularly well, I may just listen to the band or the artist occasionally, but I will not develop a real interest. If that first step is covered and I do get interested in the band, the next thing that happens is that I will start collecting. So that's what happened to me with Primus and with Bowie and David Byrne and other musical acts. So that's the most interesting part for me, you know, getting the complete discography. And once I have done that, the next step is getting all the variants. So yeah. I'm going to try to get Japanese versions. I'm going to try to get overseas pressings, which have different artwork and things like that. And, you know, reading over those articles, I tend to agree with a lot of the things that they say. The fun is looking for them and the thrill of receiving them and then adding them to your archive. All of it is a really enjoyable process.
Yeah.
What do you think?
Yeah. Well, you picked some really good ones, especially the Bowie and Primus, given the visual element. And there is that... I guess there's that element of comfort and emotional connection that you're kind of pouring into these material things to either relive or really hold on to the experience. And that was what was fascinating to me. As I look around my part of Primus Tracks World Headquarters here, I have a few dozen Primus show prints on the wall. About half of them are actually shows I went to. The rest I just thought were really great, so I snapped them up. And I have a room full of these framed prints, and there are, you know, 300 at this point. I'm never going to be I will never have all of them, but it's fun to pick and choose and try to fill up this space with these visual things that – or these visual representations that speak to me. So what's funny to me is I'm not going after all of these variants and all of the vinyl and all of – I just – if I've got the CDs, I'm pretty happy, and I don't even need all the different versions. I do collect to a certain degree, and I, you know, I've probably got 10, 15,000 baseball cards, you know, on a shelf in this room, and I don't look at them anymore, but it's nice to, when I open that cupboard to grab something else, that they're there. You know, and I don't know if you identify with that at all or if anybody listening does, but it's like, yes, this was part of me, you know, 20, 30 years ago.
Right.
So fascinating.
Yeah. I mean, when you go to a Primus show, it's always great coming back home with a poster. Yeah. And, you know, I really admire those poster collectors because, you know, With my Primus collection, I specialized a lot in the release, in the discographic releases. So I got all the vinyl, all the CD, and even, you know, the demo tapes. But the poster area is something that I didn't really dive into. So I just got a few, and they are just from shows which I attended. Right. So I really admire those people who actually track down all the variants of a particular poster. And, you know, they're always ready to order them when they are available and sell out within minutes. I mean, it's really amazing to see those collections online.
Right. Yeah. It's probably a good thing you have not gotten into that because of just for the benefit of your bank account. So,
yeah.
I was curious about that because it's that collection thing. I think a lot of people that are listening have that to a degree, and it doesn't have to be Primus. It could be just about anything. We're all collectors to some degree.
Forgive me if I hesitated.
We should get into the show here. First things first, Captain Shiner's yacht. If you are interested in getting a ride on Captain Shiner's yacht, it may or may not be fictional. I haven't figured that out yet. You can help support the show and the server costs by sending a few bucks to us via PayPal. My email address is smashysmashy@gmail.com. If you do so, you know, you send us $5 or something, I'll send you 4 beautiful Primus Track stickers designed by Frankie, printed by Sticker Robot. However many dollars you want to spare, want to send, we are very appreciative. And of course, we will send you some stickers in return. And as Frankie likes to say, send us pictures of where you slap them up around town and we'll share them on our Instagram. I say that you like to say that and then I say it. I'm sorry, I'm taking your thunder there, man. So today, I want to give a shout out to Jesse Calton. You have earned your spot on a ride in Captain Shiner's yacht. Jesse actually emailed me and the subject line was, "Is this Captain Shiner's yacht?" question mark. And he was just making sure that I was me or he was getting it to the correct email address. And he had that in the subject line. Based on his usage of that in the subject line, what I told him and what I'm going to tell you guys is I really want that to be our secret phrase for Primus Tracks fans. So if you're at a live show or just walking around seeing what you can see, if you're walking around at a Primus show, just start screaming, "Is this Captain Shiner's yacht?" And if somebody responds yes, you know, you have to respond yes, or you have to respond, yeah, come take a ride or something. And that's the secret phrase. That's the passcode. And then you know you found another Primus Tracks listener. Keep that in mind whenever live music comes back. And I'm really looking forward to that at the next show I go to.
And remember, focus on the show and enjoy it. But also, yes. Stay alert for weird conversations taking place around you.
We need to open that up. We need to open up the phone lines and have people call in and share their weird Primus live experiences, especially the conversations that happen around them. I'm sure they are legion, and I'm sure they are just absolutely delightfully amusing and disturbing. Let's get to miscellaneous debris. Wow, Frankie, people love Mr. Crinkle. And I think we had our finger on the pulse last episode about this being a really great introductory track or a Primus primer, if you will. This got a really huge reaction. Even Nick, I believe, from the Los Bastardos band, our friends across the pond there who have a Primus tribute band, they said, oh, yeah, this is the one that they would use to introduce people as well. Mr. Crinkle, that is.
I think after Tommy and Jerry, this is definitely one of the most accessible numbers. And, you know, I was quite surprised to find out that I was wrong regarding my theory that Pork Soda was a universal favorite. It turns out people actually favor, well, Seas of Cheese and Frizzle Fry more than Pork Soda. The thing is that Pork Soda is the record that is always available at any record shop that you go to. I think I've seen it in the racks more often even than Frizzle Fry. So maybe that led me to think that it was the most universally acclaimed Primus album. But even if it's not, it does have Mr. Crinkle on it, which is definitely a fan favorite.
Oh, without a doubt, yes. Oh, and I should mention, yeah, there was a poll on the Primus subreddit, somebody testing
the
theory.
Yeah, there was a tremendous backlash. Tremendous backlash.
It was about the opposite of your prediction, I think. I think it was, instead of 90-10, it was 10-90 or 20-80 or whatever your number was, flip it. And And it was surprising to me, too. I actually thought it would get more representation, but I'm also not surprised that it's more widespread and that Frizzle Fry and Caesar Cheese get a little bit more love across the spectrum there. Interesting stuff going on there. Boy, Mr. Crinkle, like I said, fan favorite. So that was a lot of fun to talk about. This time, we're talking about the subsequent track. And strangely, Frankie, it's the last track on Pork Soda, 12 out of 15, with printed lyrics. The three after this don't have any printed or actual lyrics to them. So this is our last one with words. It's kind of weird to think of that there are three instrumentals that end this album. But here we are at The Air Is Getting Slippery. Let's start with live history. And like I said, I have no idea the live history except for one little thing. So can you help us out?
Yeah. It was performed a few times in 1993 in support of the album. I say a few times because it did not have, you know, very heavy rotation. After that, it was performed again very few times in 1994. You know, that strange time in Primus history when they were done performing, you know, promoting Pork Soda. And it was sort of a transition year. A couple of times in 1998 with Brain, which is really interesting. Huh. And then this is where things get even more interesting. It completely vanished from set lists until the triumphant return of Tour de Fromage. But even then, it was only performed once on Tour de Fromage. That's November 19, 2003 in Lewiston. And then it would be performed only once more in March 13, 2004 in Washington, D.C., That performance in particular is quite interesting because of the speech that precedes the performance. It's interesting because Les mentions that, you know, they've been rehearsing a lot of tunes, and in the process they have rediscovered songs which they hadn't played in years.
Yeah.
And this is one of them. And after that, as you know, it completely vanished until it had to be performed, you know, and I say had to because it was part of the Pork Soda New Year's Eve. If it wasn't for that, I'm pretty confident 2004 would have been the last time the song was performed to date. And took place on the upright bass, which is the way the song was recorded. But the New Year's Eve performance, on the other hand, was an interesting turn of events. And I'll hand it over to you to describe, Josh, because you were there.
You took my line. I was going to try to interject somewhere, but you can have that one. They actually closed the curtains after Mr. Crinkle, and there was and the stage went dark. The lights come back up, and the curtains closed, and the band is at the very front of the stage. Tim is center stage, sitting on a bucket. He's got his drumsticks, and he's clacking away on another upturned bucket. And Larry's got his six-string banjo, stringed and tuned, standard tuning like a guitar. And Les came out with the dobro bass as opposed to his upright. So the three of them are playing, and they're wired, of course, but it sounds and looks like it's just a little acoustic jam backstage type thing, which I really thought was a cool little touch to it. And then after a little while, Les's pal and neighbor, I believe, Wiley Wood, came out on his mandolin and joined them for a portion of The Air Is Getting Slippery. So it was a very different performance and very fun, given that they kind of changed what was going on stage. And it was just standard lighting, too. So it was probably great for photographers like our friend Elizabeth Gore, who snapped a great photo of the four of these guys on stage playing this track. The one thing I'm going to point out, and Frankie, you're familiar with this photo, I'm sure.
Yeah, everybody who's listening should head over to Elizabeth's website right now and check out that photo because it's absolutely superb.
Absolutely. Egorphoto.com, by the way, EGOHRphoto.com. She is awesome. Spoiler alert. We talked to her. You're going to hear our interview with her a little bit down the line here. The one thing I'm going to point out about that photo, Tim looks absolutely ripped. When you take a look at his biceps and triceps, I was like, dang, really fun performance. And it was out of the ordinary. And we'll play a clip from it later because it definitely sounds different on the dobro bass. But it was great. That was one I was kind of looking forward to.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was a fantastic choice to have the curtain down and the full lightning. It's really unexpected. And I think they chose the right track to have, you know, that visual diversion. It kind of breaks the monotony from from the visuals and the darkness of the stage. And I don't think it's a song that everybody in particular was waiting for, so it made it quite fun to witness. I think it was a great move.
Absolutely. And considering the lyrical content, can you imagine what would have been on screen as they played it if they hadn't closed the curtain? Boo. So, good choice. Thank you, Primus. I appreciate that. Yeah, not much of a live history there. Based on what I can see on Toasterland, we have 20 known live performances, and I'm pretty sure I saw the last one we'll ever see. So,
yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. I guess let's head into the song itself. So this track, unlike much of the rest of the album, this track and Hail Santa, they were recorded not in the warehouse, not at the log cabin like Wounded Knee, but at Les's house, otherwise known as The Corn. Now, this is his house in Berkeley, in which he's got those famed and elusive demos called From the Corn, Frankie, that you've been chasing for years.
Oh, that's really interesting.
Right. So, and if you have your To Defy the Laws of Tradition photo book by Jay Blakesburg handy, you can see some photos from The Corn, a.k.a. the basement of Les's house. That one that you like to point to where they're holding up the children's toy, which will appear on this album, that photo's in Les's basement. So, and our friend Joe Gore, who wrote that making of, who wrote the album diary for Guitar Player magazine for the making of Pork Soda, actually met up with them at Les's house as well. And part of that article, I remember Les is talking about miking techniques and all the different ways he could get different sounds in his basement. And this is one of the tracks that was recorded there. So it definitely sounds different as far as production values, because it's recorded in his home studio as opposed to on their live rigs in that warehouse. So the soundscape is certainly, or the production and the soundscape itself, I should say, certainly different.
Yeah, you can totally tell.
Right. So this one's a bit drier, not as resonant, and it really does feel a little more claustrophobic as far as the recording goes. It's not as wide open as a sound as we get in the, I guess, in the warehouse. Maybe I am allowing that to cloud my thinking or to influence my thinking that these guys are just jammed into a little room together, much like you can see in the photos in the book or as they portrayed it on stage on New Year's Eve. It's kind of cool, though, because it's one of those intimate songs in the sense that we're all close together, not intimate in the content, because it couldn't be further from intimate on the spectrum of what's going on with the lyrics. The song itself, I wanted to talk about, Frankie, because the instrumentation and the rhythm and the patter of the drums, you know, on that little kit, and I assume Tim is just playing the kit that Les has at his house, it really kind of has a vaudeville vibe to it, or some kind of bawdy show from the 1910s or 1920s, when I think of kind of a stereotypical song. And I'm going to tell you, Frankie, I was humming this tune earlier in the week. You know, washing dishes or something. I'm just humming the melody because this is the song I have in my head for the week as we're getting ready to record. And my wife says, "Are you humming that Eddie Cantor song?" And I said, "What in the world are you talking about?" And she said, "I did this." And she tells me that she did this presentation. I don't remember if she was a student at the time or an instructor at the time, but she did this presentation about the suffragettes, the women that were agitating to get the right to vote in the early 1900s. And she said she included this song by Eddie Cantor in it to show the efforts of the suffragettes, and because it made its way into popular music. And it's not exactly like this Air Is Getting Slippery, of course, but it's very reminiscent of it in style and in a little part of the harmony, which I found fascinating. So this is Eddie Cantor, and this track is called The Modern Maiden's Prayer, and it is a suffragette song from 1917. As you can imagine, it's not the greatest quality recording, and I'm not going to play the whole thing, but I am going to play the first part of it for you guys. Right there, though.
When Grandma was a girlie, it was a custom. Each night before she put up her hair and curls.
So, Frankie, did you hear the ba-na-ba-na-na-na?
Yeah. You know, that actually sounds like music they would play during the interlude at a Primus show.
Right, yeah. And you know, the thing is, we know that Les is really into his old cartoons that he watched when he was a kid and older movies, black and white movies, musical movies. You know, they were probably more made in the 40s and 50s and 60s as he was a child of the 60s and 70s. But to reach way back to 1917 or so, that style of music, you're absolutely right. They'll play that during intermissions, between bands and that sort of thing, before Clown Dream comes on, right? And you know that they're about to take the stage at the start of a show.
Right. And, you know, now that you mentioned all of these, you know, the time period and that now that you play that soundbite, it just made me think that the air is getting slippery. Is kind of, you know, it could be influenced or it could be a result of the short-lived but legendary side thing, Bob Cock and the Yellow Sock. What
right.
do you think?
I was going to ask you about that. I didn't know if they ever played this track as Bob Cock and the Yellow Sock, but it's very reminiscent of the smooth jazz or old-timey.
Yeah, absolutely. You can perfectly imagine it during the sets from those legendary concerts. I think the experience that they had playing that way during those shows carried over to this tune. I think it's perfectly possible.
And it totally tracks for me that they would reach back, well, about 80 years at that point, close to 100 years, about 100 years now, to find some elements of music to model it after. You know, it's not exactly like that Eddie Cantor tune, but you can hear a similar, and you know that do-do-do-do-do-do. Whoever came up with that first, they'd be a bajillionaire because you hear it in a lot of tunes, I guess is what I'm trying to say. It's not entirely ubiquitous, but it is one of those common harmony lines that you'll hear sometimes. And, you know, Les took it and ran with it. So it's very reminiscent of some of these older tunes, and I learned a little something about the suffragettes along the way, so I feel like a cultured person. So very vaudevillian, I guess, in the approach as far as the instrumentation, especially in the lyrics, because they're so suggestive and bawdy. And they put it all together, and it really does, they really do gel nicely as they play it. But the way that it's presented, of course, it's, to me, it's not, you know, it's another novelty track. But this one, only a couple minutes long and has really kind of satisfying instrumentation, actually. They really put it together, and it is a fun one to listen to. But I'll tell you my favorite part. Larry's banjo solo is wonderful.
Oh, yes, that's absolutely fantastic. And I think live, he takes it to the next level.
I wonder if this is the track, because this is around the time, I guess it was a couple years down the road, he got a banjo endorsement out of it. At some point, so he was ripping it up on the banjo, not like a Bela Fleck or a Steve Martin, the two most famous banjo players I can think of.
Not actually a real person, but a fictional character, the Keith who plays banjo on Deliverance. As you know, the Keith couldn't actually play the banjo, so there's a professional banjo player behind him with his arms inside his sleeves, who is playing the banjo, and the Keith was just there to, you know, to land his face for the shot. The thing is that this is a song which was sampled in My Name is Moth. You know, that tells you straight away that it's one of those films that Les Claypool loves.
Oh, right.
Though
yeah.
It makes you wonder if the use of the banjo is something that he truly appreciates and he's incorporating it into his music for that reason, or if there is some element of satire to it, perhaps. You know, if it's something ironic. Because the portrayal of these characters in the movie is far from flattering.
Right, yeah. Well, we do know, too, and he talks about it much later, and his musical direction goes that way, too, as he listened to a lot of, I can't remember who he said it was, it might have been his stepdad or his granddad or somebody, always had some old country station on when he went to visit, and that was always on in the garage. So he heard a lot of Stompin' Tom Connors and a bunch of different Jerry Reed, of course, who they would cover down the road, and a lot of country artists. So that is part of his musical upbringing as well. So all of these things, I think, are coalescing into this track, all of those influences, and turning into something, I get, you know, and I'll say vaudevillian, because that's what it is to me. And to that end, I just want to play a portion of Larry's solo because it just makes me so happy.
Larry. Banjo.
Oh, yeah. Love those trills. And that part. I could play the whole thing, but over and over and over again. It's so fun putting it out.
Yeah, I mean, it's certainly a very satisfactory solo.
It is satisfying for sure. Because once again, he's just playing all the wrong notes and it sounds so great. But he stays within the bounds of the rhythm too, especially when he's wrapping up the solo. And that's really great because it comes to a satisfying ending. It's not just a mishmash mess, but he comes back around to the rhythm and what Les is laying down and plays within it. And then there's that false stop. And it sounds great. Let's go ahead and play it because I love it so much. This part right here. Oh, yeah. So that's my favorite part of the track. You know, so musically, I don't have much to say other than I love that banjo solo. We believe that he recorded this on his upright at the Corn, and that sounds kind of gnarly, too. It sounds, you know, it's not distorted, but it just sounds like it's right in your ear, which is pretty cool. Let's talk lyrics. Hoo boy. So,
oh, yeah.
So I think lyrically, you know, at least by word count, this is the longest or has the most lyrics of any track in this album, which is hilarious to me. So, we can go verse by verse because there are actually a lot of references in this track as well. So we have the air is getting slippery and it's not to my surprise. And this song is all about sweat, which is just so lovely. You know, my heart, it beats irregularly. The sweat, it fills my eyes. I do not mind what I excrete because I'm here to make a buck, which tells me, is this guy a male prostitute? I don't know. Or if he's working really hard and sweating. And he says, and those that cannot take the heat can take a flying. And then we get the forgive me if I hesitate, which we get a few times. And so we know that that's going to come back around because that's the motif there to cover up for the use of the F word. So we always get a nice rhyme right before that, and it's implied what he's actually going to say. So we get that a few times. And then in that second verse, we get the dogs are barking merrily as Jerry sits on high. Which Jerry do you think this is, Frankie?
Could be Jerry Garcia. That's the first thing that comes to my mind.
Me too. You know, for many years, I thought he was talking about Jerry, the race car driver in heaven, sitting on high because he, you know, probably died from driving drunk. But I would be like, wait a minute, why would a drunk driver be in heaven if you subscribe to all that stuff? So I'm thinking, and because of the word merrily, I'm thinking of the Merry Band of Pranksters, that sort of thing. So I think it is Jerry Garcia, because right in the next line, he says, if you've studied your Floyd properly, you'd know that pigs could fly. That, of course, is a reference to Pink Floyd's Animals, one of the more influential albums on a young Les Claypool.
Right.
And we got that Frog Brigade Live Frogs set 2, which covered it in its entirety.
Right. And, you know, going back a bit to the beginning, I'm here to make a buck. I think this could be explained by looking at a song from Les Claypool's solo catalog from the Holy Mackerel record. It's called Running the Gauntlet.
Ah.
And it's a song that explores the business side, you know, the business perspective from being a musician and playing on stage. I think that's what he's referring to in this song as well. You know, he's talking about business. He's just there to play music, to earn money.
Oh, gotcha. Sure. So that actually tracks for me. So I've been to plenty of Primus shows that are indoors, and it is hot in there. So if that's where we're going with it, yes, those sweatbox auditoriums and little music clubs that they would play for years and years and years. So, all right, I'll go with that. It beats the prostitute thing for me, I think. So coming back, he says, study your Floyd properly. You know that pigs could fly, pigs on a wing and that sort of thing. And then he says, now, if you want an encore, I swear he says, now, if you want an encore, you might hear Is It Luck. But printed in my lyrics book is, you might hear It Is Luck. But he says,
no.
Is It Luck, right? Is he not referencing the Primus track, Is It Luck, which is thematically similar, I guess, with the sexually charged? Okay. I wonder why it's printed It Is Luck as opposed to the song title. No idea. But this,
yeah, that's a strange.
Yeah. And this is a funny couplet to me, though, because he says, now, if you want an encore, you might hear Is It Luck. But me, I'd rather play Residence because I don't give a forgive me if I hesitate. So we which is so funny. Like, I'd rather play the Residence than my own band's tunes. I love that. But he's referencing a lot of his influences. Floyd, the Residence, even Jerry. We know that Larry is a huge Jerry Garcia fan. I remember a quote from Larry in an interview many years ago where he said, going to a Grateful Dead show is like other people going to a jazz show. That's his jazz. He's studying it. He's taking it in and just kind of appreciating the atmosphere, but also trying to figure out or see what it is that Jerry Garcia is up to, and probably the other musicians too. So that's really cool that we're getting these references. Then we get to the third verse. Fatty, he's a hell of a guy, but he sweats like a dancing mule. That's a wonderful visual. He likes to hang out at Checker Gas with the Chets he knew from high school. Have you heard them talk about the Chets before?
No, I don't think so.
Okay, so the Chets, this is from, I couldn't tell you which live show they talk about the Chets, but they also have talked about them in interviews before. Because, you know, Les grew up in El Sobrani, and I think Larry, I forget exactly where he grew up, but it was outside the city, kind of in the hills, in the hill country. I know it's hard to imagine, but around the San Francisco area, you know, you go out about 20 minutes, you're kind of in redneck country depending on where you go. And I don't think I'm telling tales, because the people in the Bay Area will probably tell you the same thing. So the Chets were kind of the hillbilly redneck guys. Of course, Larry was doing stuff like death metal, and Les was doing whatever Les wanted to do. So the Chets, they probably didn't get along with the Chets, and they were not the highest class individuals. So Fatty's hanging out with the Chets at the gas station, and then he sold enough crystal meth to buy a stepside truck. There's another meth reference. We get a lot of them because that was prevalent in that area for years and years and years, probably still is.
I love that you were able to figure out, you know, these particular elements from the lyrics. There are things that don't really cross your mind, you know, to check out. You kind of take them for granted when you're listening to the track, and it's amazing to discover there's this whole background to it. Now that you singled out that lyric, it makes me wonder, you know, being that the characters and the situations in Les's writing are so cyclical in the way that, you know, he tends to reuse situations and characters all the time. Because, I mean, you have, for example, those damn blue collar tweakers, and then you have Up on the Roof. And you wouldn't make the connection right away, but both songs have a lot in common. So now that you've singled out the lyrics, it makes me wonder if this guy, Fatty, could be my friend Fats.
I've thought the same thing over the years, and there's really only one person who can confirm that, and they will probably never be on this podcast. So we'll have to find out some way. But you're absolutely right. I mean, just the name Fatty. But apparently he's able to hang with Les and company, but he also hangs with the Chets. So maybe he's one of these guys that can just go between circles and not bat an eyelash, which might actually – that could be Fats, because he's a hell of a guy. Well, he's got to be high, but he's a lot of fun to be around and can probably – navigate different social circles without problems because he's maybe so charismatic. To the last verse, we have the act of perspiration is far beyond control. If heat compels you to aspirate, please try not to miss the bowl. And then my favorite delivery of any line in this track is this line here. If sweating, it's fun just to read it straight. If sweatiness makes you horny, well, darling, I think you're in luck. But of course, on the track itself, Les is kind of channeling that vaudevillian. If sweatiness makes you horny, there's something going on there. I remember that line really got to me when I was a kid, because this is actually one of the first Primus tracks I heard. This was on a mixtape. I've talked about this before. My good friend in 7th or 8th grade handed me these mixtapes of a bunch of different, you know, rock and metal artists. And I know that this track was on one of those tapes. So I remember listening to this and just being like, what the hell is this band? I love them. Printed in the lyrics we get, because all of this clever banter gives me the urge to you know what. But it's printed in the lyrics book. But of course, it's obscured if it's said at all on the track. But it's obscured by the breaking glass. So I don't know, Frankie, can you hear the word uttered on the record? I don't think I've ever heard it. I think it's just the breaking glass.
Yeah, I think the breaking glass is the only thing you actually hear.
Yeah. So I think there's a couple layers to this. I think part of it was he wanted to do, he even refers to it as clever banter. So, you know, a little self-congratulatory, yeah. Maybe, Frankie, I don't know. But the idea there is to, you know, to reference the word, which that's the part. It's so suggestive. This track is so suggestive. That's why I keep going back to the vaudevillian descriptor. But it's so suggestive. And then right when he's actually going to say the word, there's the breaking glass. And I wonder, though, if that was – it was to be clever and it was to continue that motif. But at the same time, if he had said it on record, I bet this record would have been slapped with a parental advisory.
Yeah, I think exactly the same thing. And correct me if I'm wrong, but wasn't Golden Boy the first Primus song to have the F word on it?
Definitely the one where it was the most audible, I can tell you that. Yeah. In this track, it's just used as a device. And it is fairly clever. I'll give him that. I wonder if it's the patter of this. And I do wonder, you know, much like You Like It, where he just won't perform it anymore because he hates the lyrics, given that they're so puerile. I wonder if this one has limited live performances because of the lyrical content as well. Maybe he's matured out of it.
Yeah, I tend to agree with you on that one.
Let's get into live versions. What do we got first, Frankie?
All right, Josh, we have a really cool rendition from Hallucinogenetics in 2004 that took place in Washington, D.C. And the cool thing about this one is that, bear in mind, it's the only time it was performed in 2004, and it's the last time it would be performed until the Pork Soda New Year's Eve. So what you're about to hear is, you know, something pretty unique and extremely rare. And we're going to play the solo for you because we think it's, you know, it's something to behold.
To DC. Some of that banjo. Achoo!
Frankie, if I could bottle Larry LaLonde, I think it would sound like that.
Yeah, it's really spectacular, isn't it?
Oh, it's phenomenal. It's just so him. All these little phrases, but then he's playing like these scary arpeggio sounded things, and then he's just doing the Larry thing. Oh, man, that's great. And it sounds really, really good. Just sound quality-wise, of course, that's a soundboard from Primus Live. So really great stuff there. That's a fun one to enjoy, you know? You don't have to rock out the entire time when you're listening to Primus. That was a fun one.
Yeah, it's nice to catch a breath.
Yeah, for sure. What do we have next?
We have the last performance to date, which is the Pork Soda New Year's Eve 2015 at the Fox Theater in Oakland. So, as everybody knows...
I was there!
Right on.
Thank you for cueing me. Wow, that was great. It's like we have a connection.
as we mentioned before, it's on the Dobro, which was a peculiar choice. And I want to ask you, Josh, can you tell us how the recording holds up against actually being there sound-wise?
This is on YouTube, and this is from a guy who filmed the entire set of Pork Soda, and bless his heart for doing so, because I was a little busy enjoying it, so I didn't really take any pictures or video that night. So... album too. I'll stop it right there. So it's a little bit tinny, and this might be this guy's phone, right? It sounds a little bit tinny. It had a fuller sound that night, but it looks and feels stripped down because once again Tim is just playing a bucket and Les is playing his dobro,
yeah,
which has a little more rubbery sound than the upright, so it definitely sounds different, but it's a fun rendition. And looking at this video, there are a lot of phones up, probably because it's hard to mosh to this track, but it was a lot of fun. I really enjoyed this. It was kind of a nice break, and it preceded the New Year's Eve countdown when they opened the stage back up and something wonderful happened during Hamburger Train, which we'll talk about next episode.
Sure.
Yeah. So not too many live performances, but this one was truly unique as far as instrumentation and presentation. And so that was a lot of fun.
There.
Well, the air is getting slippery. I'm going to pour some cold water on you, buddy, because you've been tracked. next time, Frankie, we're actually going to wrap up Pork Soda. We usually do one track at a time, but we are going to pull in the final three tracks, Hamburger Train, Pork Chops, Little Diddy, and Hail Santa all together and wrap up Pork Soda. I can't believe I'm saying that.
Something to look forward to.
Thank you once again, everybody, for listening. We're at Primus Tracks on Instagram and Twitter. Get yourself some stickers. Keep enjoying Primus as we are too. Later days.
Willie Mace.
Makes you horny. Well, darling, I think you're in luck. 'Cause all of the